that is being used as a replacement for animal therapy in nursing homes, which is really kind of awesome.
So she builds planets on Earth, you guys.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our very special event, And What About You, Sir? I'm James Wetzel, the producer of adult programs at the Museum of Science Boston, and I'm so thrilled to be here tonight to introduce and be in conversation with our co-producer on this event, the one and only Throb Zombie from the Slaughterhouse Society. We are here tonight to share the stories of six incredible drag king performers from all around the world who are going to talk about how gender and orientation and identity all influence and inspire their art. And we're just so thankful that they are allowing us to share their stories and bring them into all of your homes tonight. So a huge thank you to our performers. And this evening is a part of our current summer virtual season of adult programming, which is a part of our MOS at Home initiative. We have turned the Museum of Science into a virtual museum, offering free STEM-related content on a daily basis across our digital platforms. And as a part of that, we have launched our SubSpace Adult Programs After Dark channel to host tonight's event, as well as the rest of our schedule. And tonight is the end of our current summer season. However, our fall lineup is just around the corner. We'll be kicking things off again on September 15th. And we announced that first half of that season today. You can check that out by going to mos.org/adults and register for your spot for those events and sign up for our email address so you can stay up to date on everything happening this fall at the museum for adults. Now, a little bit later on this evening, you'll have the chance to ask your questions to Throb, and you can submit those at any time tonight by going to slido.com and entering the code DRAGKING. That's SLIDO.com, and we'll try and get through as many of those with Throb as we can a little bit later on. Now, I need to thank our friends from the Lowell Institute for their continued support of the adult programming here at the museum. Without them, we would not be here tonight, this event would not be happening, and it would not be free. So please join me in giving a huge virtual round of applause and thanks to our friends from the Lowell Institute. And finally, after the show tonight, I ask you to consider making a gift by going to donate.mos.org/mos@home and allow us to keep bringing free virtual STEM experiences like tonight's into your homes. Once again, that's donate.mos.org/mos@home. But now it is my honor to welcome to your screens our co-host and co-producer of this event, the one and only Throb Zombie. Hello, Throb.
Hi, I'm so happy to be here.
We are so happy to have you here. It's so wonderful to see you in person.
Yes.
Normally, we are used to collaborating with Throb and Slaughterhouse in the planetarium on our annual Drag King extravaganza under the dome. But unfortunately, as we all know, we can't be together with an audience in that space right now. But I did want to say that we're so happy that, Throb, you've put this night together and we can have this conversation and show a little bit of a different side of this community of artists. Tonight, the museum is reopened for the public. You can come and visit us safely. We have the proper safety protocols in place. So we are streaming live from the museum tonight, and Throb is here with us. And we just wanted to give you a peek of what this setup is so you could be assured that we are following all health precautions and keeping safe. So you can see Throb and I are on complete opposite sides of the stage right now, more than 20 feet apart. We have a barrier between us, and our wonderful tech crew is in the back of the house running the show. So we just want to thank everyone at the museum who have worked over the past couple of weeks in making tonight happen and keeping all of us safe. But now, let's dive right in. We have an incredible lineup and show. Throb, you have put this together. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you curated tonight's show?
Well, tonight's very much in vain in terms of things that I try to curate as a producer. For those who don't know, I run a troupe here in Boston called the Slaughterhouse Society. It was once a burlesque troupe about 10 years ago, but it's since evolved into kind of this ragtag group of performing artists from all different backgrounds with all different skills, different body types, all different things, just really showcasing that talent comes in all forms from all places. And a few years ago, we started doing drag shows. Our flagship drag show, Magic Dyke, actually has continued and is now a yearly event. And the big kind of theme of that show was to create something like Magic Mike, but for the rest of us. Yes. So while the Man of Magic Mike are very beautiful, there's many more types of beauty, especially within the queer community and the drag community. And so unfortunately with COVID, we haven't been able to continue with those shows. But with this, I thought it was a wonderful opportunity to take that concept outside of Boston and bring it all here in one place. And I just wanted to find kings from all over, with all different types of drag, with all different types of identity, and just really showcase that it doesn't mean one thing to be a drag king artist. It means really the room is open to go anywhere as a drag artist in general. And I think we have a really amazing cast of kings, things, in-betweens from all over the place, just kind of showing how diverse this medium can be.
I love it. And that's sort of what the driving force originally with this concept was for the two of us, right?
Yes.
We wanted to show that there's so much to drag and what and who a drag artist is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you've put together an incredible lineup. We're so lucky. And I think it's time to meet our first artist, if you agree.
Yes. I actually do not like this artist. They're a total hack. We shouldn't have hired them. They lied about their credentials. It's
no,
me.
No.
Throb Zombie.
So you know that you're one of my favorite performers ever, not even just within in Boston. And I just would love to hear, what has your experience been as a drag king in Boston?
My experience as a drag king in Boston. Well, I come from kind of an interesting perspective. I didn't join this community as a new performer who was meeting people in community building for the first time. I had already about 7 years experience as a producer in kind of the queer art scene. And coming into this, I feel like I was very lucky and privileged to already be acknowledged as an existing member of the Boston performing arts community. And I was given a lot of opportunities based solely on relationships and being able to cast other people and get to know them in that way. So I've been very lucky in that context, but there's also, of course, been the downsides I've realized that are the difference of being a drag king in this community versus being a drag queen. So it's been a mixed bag. For the most part, I've had a really great experience learning a lot about what I need and what I want to see for the future of this community as it continues to support more performers who don't identify as drag queens. So it's been really inspiring through some frustration.
Yeah. And we'll touch on that. I mean, that's a theme that I think comes up a lot tonight in a lot of the videos is the difference between drag queens and drag kings and acceptance in pop culture and in you know, venues. But before we go there, I love that reel because it just shows how diverse of a performer you are. For me, it's always so exciting when you're taking the stage because I never know what I'm going to get. And it's just thrilling as an audience member. And so can you just talk a little bit about like what inspires you as Throb Zombie as an artist?
Sure. Well, for me, I say drag king because it's an easy descript, but more I identify as a performing artist. I would see myself as more of a gender opportunist. So whenever I have an act, I really just go towards presenting myself in the way that most inspires me for that particular show or song, really anything in that regards. I just kind of try to keep it fluid on stage. And I like being unrecognizable show by show by show. So the whole theme of shape-shifting is incredibly inspiring to me. But Throb in general, like baseline Throb, it's kind of just a bigger grown-up extension of what my burlesque persona once was. I love dark, spooky, magical horror movies. I like gross humor. I love to make people laugh. I love to provide a sensuality that's a little edgy, things like that. And the ability to take my past experience as a dancer and apply that to my presentation as a drag king is very, very exciting. So I would say in general, as a performer, that's the stuff that really gets me excited. But yeah. I also really like trying new stuff. So yeah.
And you do. And like I said, it's so incredible to watch and be in the audience. And your audiences are not unfamiliar with like the splash zones, right? Is that what you call them?
Yeah, so the splash zone is a Slaughterhouse Society. It's just one of our favorite things. So sometimes we'll be able to do shows where we are allowed by the venue to make a mess. You know, some shows that's super not allowed, but people will pay extra for a Slaughterhouse Society show to sit in the splash zone where they will be puked on or heads will explode and hit them. Or if it's Magic Dyke, the dancers will approach them and dance on them or bring them off stage or on stage, depending on the performer. But really, it's just something that really inspires, like, as a producer and showmaker, is the fun element of live performance being interactive. Mm-hmm. We try to make it very clear if you don't want to be touched by us, if you don't want interaction, that we totally respect those boundaries. We literally make, like, pins you can wear that say, please choose me. And so I love providing that in a performance space.
Well, and you're all so immersive and interactive, and that's why the work in the dome that we do with you is just groundbreaking. And I know that you're inspired all the time by other performers and people around you and what's happening in the scene. So let's learn a little bit more about one of those performers, shall we?
Yeah. So our first performer of the evening is a king I've never worked with in person. It's another performer who I've been lucky enough to be introduced to through social media as we extend this community online in these times. They're from Columbus, Ohio. I love their dancing. I love their mug. I love their aesthetic. And I'm really, really excited to have them in this show, and that is Shorty West.
Hi, my name's Shorty West, and I'm here to talk to you about drag. Drag started for me about 6 years ago. I literally just thought of it as a form of art and a form of entertainment. So it didn't really seem like so obscured or abnormal. It was just very easy to be sucked into. I would say you can treat it as me being in a restaurant. I started in the back of the house and started in front of the house. Started working behind the scenes, helping with set design and things like that. And I had my name before I actually started drag. And it was something I always wanted to do, but I never really truly had the confidence to do it. I think my confidence started to develop behind the scenes because I saw so many people and what they did, their passion. So I decided to get into it. And I remember my first big show, I did James Brown. And it was like the most awesome thing that I've ever done. To this day, I think it's the best performance I've ever done. Once I got in front, it was like history. It was just so very natural. So that's essentially how Shawty West came about. Going into this world of drag and becoming who I am as Shawty West, I mean, it had its experiences, had its ups and downs, and, you know, it's still challenging. Though the performance of James Brown was the best thing that I ever done, there were still things that were very challenging. Definitely had issues with my image because I felt like someone with curves, there's no way I can be able to really showcase that I'm a drag king. A lot of people don't, I feel like they don't necessarily take drag kings serious, or they don't know how to accept a drag king as an entertainer. It can still come off as a very misogynistic world. The way I'm using my drag to really talk about gender and orientation is really trying not to please the audience. Just being unapologetically me and highlight the things that are important in my life, and, you know, I'm not trying to prove how much of a man I can be. I'm just trying to prove how much of Shawty West is Shawty West, and how I'm different from every other entertainer. And sometimes that can just start as walking with confidence and walking with pride and not being ashamed to be a drag king. Shawty West is fun, cool, suave, can be political, energetic, someone who isn't afraid to be themselves. I like to think my personality, or how I present myself, is like, I'm this cool guy that is going to VIP. I'm definitely want to be that person. I want to walk in with confidence, whether people know my truth or not. But when an opportunity presents itself, show my truth or stand up for my beliefs, I will wholeheartedly do that. And when those conversations do allow itself, talk, speak up, be loud, be true to who you are, and embrace it. All in all, I love what I do, and that's the reason why I'm where I am today. It's because I love what I do. I love the world of drag. I love every entertainer that's out there that I know and I don't know. And just know that the key thing in order to continue to break barriers is to be consistent. Show yourself as much as you can, and eventually it will get embedded into people's brains that you are an entertainer, you are amazing, you are someone powerful. You know, it's an awesome feeling. Shawty West didn't happen overnight. There's still work that needs to be done. There's still growth with me and how to continue to show shoddy in different ways. Us drag kings are amazing, and we're here to stay, and we're here to entertain. So be entertained.
I love them. Spoiler alert, I'm in love with everyone in this show. But Shorty is so, they're just so fun. They're so fun. Their looks, their presence. Like, I really hope I one day get to see them live, because just from seeing their videos, you can tell they really engage the audience and get people excited and have that connection. And I'm so glad we were able to include them in tonight's program.
Yeah, I know. That's going to be the problem with the show, right? We're going to need to bring all of these performers from all over the world to
the
Dome.
I guess so. We're just going to have to fly them all here. Yeah.
Ohio is not far. But I love how genuine they seem on stage and off. And I think that's so important. And exactly what you said, it feels like they're so engaging to their audience.
Absolutely.
And that's so important. And I think, you know, it was touched upon before, but it was called out in this video by Shadi. Like, why do you think drag queens seem to be more accepted or sort of commercially understood than drag kings?
So I was trying to find a nice way to say this, and I still can. I'm just going to be kind of direct. There sometimes is this assumption that when you enter into a queer space, that there wouldn't be the issues of misogyny, which frankly is not true. Mm-hmm. And it's not always from drag queens per se. Sometimes it's producers who aren't even performers, things like that. But there's a lot of things that just aren't considered. As a producer, something that's very, very important to me is I really try to think of what my performer's experience is. You know, I want to make sure they're comfortable. They're usually literally bearing it all on stage. I want to make sure they feel like I'm approachable. I want their acts to work within my show. And that communication and that trust is very important. Something I learned very fast when I transitioned to drag performance is that's often not the experience. I don't think a lot of people who aren't drag kings realize that often when you enter into a performance space and are the only AFAB person, having the entire cast still sexualize you or assume they can touch you simply because you're a king is the same experience I get from going into, you know, in any theater space where the cast is all men. It's just not a good feeling. It makes you feel targeted. And also, why exactly have you hired a king? Are they there to be this fetishized male character to add to your show? Do you actually respect their work? And the more I talked with drag kings and asked their experiences, the more I heard stories of drag kings having to pay to play, which means having to pay to perform, whereas drag queens don't, or where the host would keep all the money and then almost have this like harem of drag kings to show off. And it's a very, very common thing I've encountered from people all over New England. And the common issue I find is they're like, well, we don't know what else we can do because there's no one to kind of think of them or really stand up for them. And so therefore they get kind of treated as less because people get away with it. And often kings just feel lucky to be included and therefore allow a lot of behavior towards them to happen, which just needs to stop, frankly. There's also just like this weird sort of double standard. This is the story I kind of always go to, is there's this unique sort of bitterness I have about nipples at this point in my artistic career. I have spent so many hours creating elegant solutions to hiding the fact that I have nipples on stage. And in the same exact theater, I can go to a show a week later and see a drag queen get 100% naked, except for tucking. Yet if I do that, I have to write a written statement to the theater of why it's important for me to feature nudity. Mm-hmm. And now as a drag king, I have to bind and then create fake male nipples to go on top of my real AFAB nipples to be like, it's just this like this never-ending weird cycle about just this very small, very silly thing that is just this prime example of the problem.
Yeah.
It's just not equal treatment. And why is it not equal treatment? It's because for a lot of situations, it's women entering a sometimes male-dominated space. And I mean, I think we're beyond that at this point, and we can do a lot better. So
yeah, and it's this weird, I mean, it's this weird thing that we even see just in our society, right? Of like people being so afraid of a woman's body.
Right.
And it's, you know, we are one of those venues. Like when we first started working with you and the troupe, there was this concern over, you know, any sort of reveals or, you know, even when, you know, a performer had bound themselves mm-hmm. and concern of even the fake nipples. So, you know, I think that there's totally that double standard and I can see that. But what you've been really helpful is educating us as an institution and sort of helping us realize, why are we so concerned about that? You know, if we're going to engage this community of artists and we're going to do this show, then we need to fully engage this community of artists.
Well, something that's really exciting is I'm seeing more kings create shows for themselves, mm-hmm. which I think we'll talk about later. But I think that's just a huge part of the step forward is creating our own spaces. And then it's always lovely if there's a diverse cast, of course. But what's even better is going to a show to support a show by kings, mm-hmm. for kings, instead of just occasionally hiring a token king, yep. or creating those platforms and supporting those platforms. But yeah.
And there's also an unfamiliarity with kings still. I feel like from like right. the pop culture world, like there is not a popular Emmy Award winning, you know, reality show about drag kings, and yeah. I think that really has created a big divide, and I think that the more people start to understand and be sort of have their eyes open to the brilliance of the drag king community,
well, and, yeah.
the acceptance, the understanding, and that sort of commercial acceptance will come along.
Well, in general, just the commercial presence of drag very much encourages a sense of competition and tearing each other down.
Yeah.
And where is that more frequent than misogyny and a gender versus gender idea, mm-hmm. when really it shouldn't be about not supporting women, but just having diverse forms of drag, mm-hmm. you know? But anyway.
Well, gender continues to be a theme that we're gonna hear a little bit about from our next performer. Can you introduce us, Throb?
I'm freaking out. I'm a huge fan of this next performer. I am deeply honored they are doing this show, and they are just this beautiful, exquisite example of exactly the sort of art I'm so happy is becoming more and more common in the drag scene. I'm going to let their video speak for themselves because I couldn't put it as eloquently as they do. From France is the one and only Hits Baloo.
Bien mieux. Bonjour à tous, je me présente, je m'appelle Itsublu et je suis drag performer ici à Paris, en France. J'ai actuellement 27 ans et je fais du drag depuis maintenant 2 ans. Alors mon personnage s'inspire pas forcément de personnes, mais plutôt de mouvements, que ce soit artistiques, littéraires ou musicaux. Je m'inspire énormément des années 80. Que ce soit pour la mode ou pour le cinéma avec les films qui sont sortis à cette époque, qui sont restent mes films préférés comme par exemple Les Goonies ou Dark Crystal de Jim Henson. Alors Itsublu, alors à la base mon pseudo sur internet c'était Itsuji Yokai, qui veut dire mouton joyeux en japonais. Et du coup tout le monde sur la communauté m'appelait Itsu. Donc c'était une communauté de dessins principalement axée sur le manga. Et Blue, ça a plein de sens différents. Déjà parce que j'ai les yeux bleus, que j'adore la couleur bleue. Mes origines italiennes, bleu s'écrit Blue. Et ça fait aussi référence à tout ce qui va être le blues, la mélancolie, plein d'autres choses en rapport avec la couleur bleue. Give her to lips like roses and clover, and tell her that her lonely nights are over. Déjà, c'est parce que je trouve qu'il n'y a rien de plus sexy qu'une moustache. Et c'est aussi parce que la moustache, au cours de l'histoire, a toujours représenté quelque chose de vraiment très masculin, très viril. Et justement, je trouve que la blague est assez sympa d'avoir cet attribut qui est ultra masculin et qui décrit la masculinité maintenant toxique, avec des yeux ultra féminins, ultra travaillés. Alors au début, quand j'ai du Club Kid, je voulais absolument ce côté il. Je voulais être masculin parce que j'avais très peu confiance en moi et très peu confiance en ma masculinité. Et du coup, je me disais, je vais me rattraper là-dedans. Et au final, je me suis rendu compte que j'avais pas ne pas avoir confiance en ma masculinité parce qu'en fait, qui j'étais était très bien comme ça. Et du coup, au fil du temps, Itsu est devenu plus ou moins féminin, plus ou moins masculin, ça dépend un peu de... des looks, des perruques, des make-up, ça peut dépendre. Et maintenant, c'est même plus une question de il, elle, ou comme on dit en français, yel, parce qu'on n'a pas vraiment de genre neutre en français, malheureusement. C'est un peu... ce que je dis aux gens, c'est généralement, tu me genres comme tu le ressens. Genre, quand tu me vois, est-ce que tu veux dire il, elle, yel, ça... Il n'y a plus aucun... Il n'y a pas de préférence pour moi, c'est... C'est aussi ça l'intérêt, c'est justement d'être au-delà de la binarité ou de la non-binarité, c'est d'être dans le non-genre. Quand je pars du principe que l'art ne donne pas de réponse mais qu'il pose des questions, pour moi au final ça faisait sens d'aller sur scène puisque je pouvais exprimer quelque chose de nouveau qui me plaît et les gens se posent des questions et tant mieux en fait parce que si les gens se posent des questions ça veut dire qu'ils sont ouverts à réfléchir. Alors je suis pas moins booké parce que j'ai de la chance d'avoir construit mon réseau social pour avoir de la visibilité et du coup aujourd'hui on me book pour mon personnage justement atypique. Que je vais être booké dans des trucs très spécifiques ou par des gens qui ont cette ouverture d'esprit et qui veulent montrer la diversité dans le milieu drag. Dans la scène drag française, on a envie de cette différence. On a envie de montrer qu'on est différent des autres scènes drag. Donc du coup quand on va me booker c'est un peu en mode regardez, on a ça aussi. Par une boîte ou par une soirée gay ou queer parce qu'ils veulent une drag queen à la RuPaul Drag Race, c'est-à-dire ils veulent une drag queen, déjà ils prennent pas de king, je trouve ça super triste, alors qu'on pourrait très bien avoir des drag kings aussi sur cette scène qui bouge sur des musiques, on pourrait avoir des drag queer ou des drag créatures aussi. Mon seul conseil, c'est exprimer ce qui vous êtes à l'intérieur. Vous soyez homme, femme, non-binaire, poulpe, chèvre, on s'en fiche. Faites ce qui vous plaît, vous pouvez être tout avec le drag et avec le make-up, c'est ça qui est magique. Donc la seule chose qui est importante, c'est de vous faire plaisir, d'être fidèle à vous-même et de respecter les autres autant que vous-même. Et le beautiful, c'est à la fois c'est l'acceptation de tout sentiment, que ce soit la... Le positif, le négatif, la colère, la joie, c'est juste du beautiful. Voilà. Donc tout ce que j'ai à vous dire, c'est du beautiful.
I'm obsessed.
Yeah, no, I mean, they're amazing. I've been following them for a long time, actually, because they're one of those artists that for, God, years at this point, I'd see them on Instagram and save it. Just so like I'd have some inspiration later because there's no, guidebook as to this. For me personally, I just find things that inspire me and kind of like collect them, and then when I need to paint my face, just burrow through it. And that's how I know about Hits Blue.
I mean, if it wasn't for the pandemic, I think I would already be on, I wouldn't be here right now, I'd be on a plane to France to check out one of the shows.
There's so honestly so many performers, especially overseas, who I would love to see like more people interacting with here in the States, because there's just so many inspirations outside of what we see here in other places. I think it just, the more is better.
Yeah. And what I love about that video is when they talk about how the character, they want them to not have a gender. They're genderless. Right. And I think it's amazing and so important that it, as a performer in an art form, in a medium that is an exploration of gender, mm-hmm. that they're showing the full spectrum of gender, right? Like, it's not binary.
Well, misogyny in drag really hurts everyone, because it starts becoming about what is womanly enough or what is traditionally man enough. And that doesn't, I mean, that's kind of just a roadblock in the way of progress, in my opinion. Why would you restrict yourself to such a small box of what our society thinks a woman is or what a man is, especially when it comes to something so fantastical and creative as drag? Now, don't get me wrong, I really love old-fashioned drag. There's mm-hmm. a lot of queens who you might be what you think of when you think of a drag queen, where you think of Gaga or Beyonce impersonators, things like that, or just queens who really love presenting womanly, beautiful. And I think those artists are incredible. But I think something that really heightens that experience as an audience member seeing that form of art is when you have a show with diversity. Because if you have a show of very similar performers, one after the other, one after the other, it's very hard for any person in particular to shine, because naturally there becomes this comparison of everybody. When drag is so much bigger and there's so much more room to create and imagine, I think it's great when you have one thing and then just switch to a totally different flavor and just highlight all these different beautiful colors of drag, giving everyone a platform and a chance to really like be their creature, you know? And so I just think like someone like Hits Blue, it's a shame they aren't booked more. I actually didn't know that when I booked them for this, because I would imagine they would be
every night
booked solid, yeah. You know? So it's very sad to me to hear that, because I can't imagine someone that talented as a producer, like like it's good for me as a producer to have such talented people. I mean, I'd be snatching them up so fast.
Yeah.
So hopefully maybe they'll gain some followers from this. If you haven't followed Hits Blue, you should. Everything they do is amazing. Spoiler alert. So.
And producers in France, get on it.
Yes.
You're so lucky to have them. This leads me to sort of another question that I have that I'm curious of. We learned a little bit about Hits Blue's, how the character was developed and created. So mm-hmm. I would love to get your thoughts on like the relationship between performer and character, and like,
sure.
How did Throb come to be?
So it's so interesting. Throb was definitely something subconscious that just kind of exploded out of me one day. You know, I did lots of years of dance, like ballet, and then I did burlesque for a very long time. I still do. And I always had kind of this like block, because burlesque is such an empowering art form. But I had a lot of trouble feeling confident if I wasn't just being funny or scary, things like that. I just had a very hard time feeling confident in how I looked, and I felt very restricted by the makeup, things like that. And then just one day, I wanted to start doing drag. So I started producing drag king shows. And most of our kings at first were also people who had never done drag, just talented dancers who I was like, oh, you should try this. You're so versatile and amazing. Let's try this out. And I realized very fast, nothing makes me feel sexier than being a gross boy. And I just fell in love with that empowerment and that acknowledgement. And in Boston, especially by my community, I've been so supported. And through that, I've gotten to explore so much about myself and like what makes me feel good, what's the kind of art I want to make. And I've just kind of gone forward with that. So whether it's scary or funny or writing entire shows and plays, I just like to really create a world and draw people into it, because the world on planet Throb is pretty fun. So.
Yeah. It's just, it's fascinating to me, that relationship. And our next performer, who is one of my absolute favorites in the city as well, has a very special story and relationship with their character as well.
So we definitely wanted to showcase people from different areas, but we also wanted to have some Boston representation because, as I said before, the Boston drag community is incredible. This person is a dear friend of mine, has been in every drag show I've ever produced, and for a reason, the ever inspiring Jaden Jameson, K.A. St. James.
Drag has reaffirmed to me more than anything that I am indeed female. Getting ready to be Jaden, when I put the makeup to masculinize my face, when I tape my breasts up, when I put my packer in my pants, you know, these are all things at the end of the show I'm glad to take off. For me, when I look down and I see my breasts, I'm so glad I have breasts. But the other things I take from the stage, the traits of what is considered masculine, being assertive, speaking up for yourself, being confident, these are all things I take off the stage and I carry with me in my own personal life. I want this community to be elevated because of drag and all the lessons I've learned from it. When Jaden came about, I was in a really bad place in my life. My mother had just passed away, and I was experiencing a lot of guilt because in hiding my sexual orientation, I missed the last 2 years of my mother's life. Growing up, from my family, I received the message that I was not turning out the way they wanted a traditional Vietnamese woman to be. And because of these messages I was receiving from my family, I decided to pretty much disassociate from my Vietnamese side because all I was feeling were feelings of rejection. I was just struggling with not feeling, having much worth in who I was. So it was at that point Jaden was born, because I felt that externally he was gonna get out what I was feeling and not experience consequences that I experienced in my own life. And in doing that, what I realized was the more I was expressing myself as Jaden, the more positive feedback I was getting from people, because people were responding to the shared human experience and emotions I was putting out on stage. And it wasn't until years later where I realized just how important my Vietnamese identity is, especially on stage. In teaching the King for a Day class, where we've had 46 students come through, it was really telling to me, because I had an Asian woman in the class say to me, "I had friends that did drag and I didn't know I could do it until I saw you." And that was mind-blowing to me. That's why King for a Day is so important, because I've had people do it as a bucket list item. I've had people do it as a drag thing because they really want to do this drag thing.
Would you like to talk a little bit about sort of in terms of, I'm so distracted.
I've had people take the course, not perform because they realize they're trans and they decided to transition instead. And so that's what drag does for the society as a whole, because it allows us to define gender as it is for ourselves. When I first started, I was just Jaden Jameson because it was a spinoff of Jenna Jameson, the porn star. So I just thought I was gonna be hot. And honestly, it's not a lot of Asian representation in the gay community. And I didn't feel desirable. So I decided to lean into the masculine side because, you know, in our society, men are embraced of being sexual and it's seen as a good thing. You know, you're seen as a stud if you're a guy and you're highly sexual. So that's how I first started, because I just wanted to be desirable in a community where I didn't feel seen as a desirable dating option. And as the years have gone by, you know, I've recognized that what I do on stage impacts my society as a whole, because I'm putting out there things I want to see in our world. And when you put that stuff out and people are responding to it, they themselves want to see that in the world. And it's like the raindrop effect. You drop a raindrop in a pool, it becomes a trickle, it becomes waves, it becomes a tsunami. So that's the change I want to see. I'm so more aware of what I put on stage and how I act towards people, because I want to model the behaviors I want to see. And then I want to eliminate the toxic behaviors that we don't want to see in our society. I'm excited what the new performers bring to the play, because they have a whole different slew of experiences than I've experienced. You know, I've been in this game for 15 plus years, so I've been able to witness, experience new different things, but this new crop of performers are seeing different things in their growing up experiences, entirely different from mine. So drag is the perfect platform to be able to explore these things, gender roles, sexual orientation, gender identities, and whatever I can do to help you feel seen and that, you know, you're not alone. And that's what really pushes me to keep performing as a drag king.
Oh my gosh, Jaden.
Yeah.
Just literally one of the most confident performers I've ever seen.
They're incredibly inspiring. And I feel from my short time working with Jaden, I've learned a lot about just what I want to do in this community, just because they say everything so with such conviction. It's just they're so clear about how they feel and what they believe in. And they actually said something pretty early on when we first started working together that's always stuck with me. And that was, a win for one of us is a win for all of us when it comes to the drag king or just drag community in general. Like, very recently, a drag king won a reality TV show as the only drag king competitor. And they didn't win for that reason. They won because they were the fiercest competitor. And when Landon Sider won, I feel a lot of kings suddenly felt validated. And that's definitely carries with me the things I want to do as a producer and a performer. I have healthy competition, absolutely. I want to get ahead, I want to accomplish, but I want to help be part of what creates space for more people, for what makes more people feel safe and brave and like, well, why, if they can do it, why can't I do it?
Yeah.
So I just think Jaden's doing amazing work with their KFAD program, which is a program where they teach people who want to start getting into drag kinging and kind of teach them the basics. And then they produce a show and all of those students get to perform and then network with people and meet more people. I think since KFAD has started, actually the drag king community in Boston has expanded substantially. There's some performers now who may have gotten into it without KFAD, but have absolutely just arrived. And mm-hmm. I'm so glad that the community is growing in a way of so many like strong, self-assured, and talented drag king performers. I think Boston is only going to become a bigger place for that. And I think that's really great. And I think Jaden's a really big part of that.
And it was so special to hear that drag really helped Jaden become comfortable with mm-hmm. themselves and their orientation and their identity. And I think that, you know, for me, I think sometimes people have this, you know, idea that drag is just sort of this extravagant nightlife, you know, for lack of a better word, like fluffy, you know, type of performance.
Right.
And it's just not. And I
think the thing is, it is and it's not. Like, that's not for me a bad word. Like,
yeah.
It is so great when there can be an act that like you feel it in your soul and it like resonates with things within you when it's just heartfelt. But I personally get so much excitement and enjoyment out of silliness.
Mm-hmm.
Silliness is so powerful and important and a huge part of drag, like comedy, silliness, ridiculousness, absurdist, whatever you want to call it. It's part of why you go see drag, because some of it is it absolutely ridiculous, but you get to be a part of it. Whatever's bothering you, whatever's on your mind, you leave it and you just enter into this space vibrating with energy, where you see ridiculous things happen and over the board beautiful, glamorous queens and kings, or frightfully disgusting, but it's all just so ridiculous in such a healthy way.
Yeah.
That level of ridiculous has absolutely kept my sanity, because if I had to be in, quote, the real world with no break into this fantastical world of silliness, I'd have a much harder time being happy.
Yeah.
And I think that's why a lot of people are so drawn to this type of performance, because it can be so extreme and over the top. And even when you have something heartfelt, you've got sometimes people with eyelashes out to here, or wigs like twice as big as they are, or wings or whatever. And it's just this level of spectacle that I haven't seen in any other performance I've done. That is why I keep returning to drag over other mediums. There's just this importance and this like pride put on how much of a spectacle you can be, how much you can say, I'm taking up this space.
Yeah.
Look at me, give me money. I'm gorgeous, I'm amazing, and I'm the best thing here. And people just wanna literally throw money at that positive message. So that's, I mean, I think silliness needs to be protected and encouraged as often as possible.
For sure. Well, I think it's just such a great expression of all sides of a performer's self. And I think our next performer definitely, is just so incredible. We're so fortunate and very lucky to be able to share their story tonight.
This performer is very unique. I've never gotten to feature someone like this before. I also found them when we started doing this project, and I was kind of like hunting for drag kings and things through the internet. This performer is a revolutionary. This performer is an educator. They are India's first drag king, and their name is Durga Shakti.
I don't want to justify or explain. I don't feel like I have to anymore. I don't want to anymore. I just want to be. Just be in this world as me. There are so many things that you are supposed to do. You are supposed to be this. You're supposed to be that. You're supposed to wear this. You're not supposed to wear that. Own yourselves. Don't let anybody else make you feel like they own you.
I am Durga Gaude, but I prefer Durga Shakti. I am a sculptor, educator, activist, and India's first performing drag king. When I started performing in drag 2 years ago, I took on the name Shakti. My given name, that is Durga, is of the goddess of power in Hinduism. When the gender is taken out of Durga, Shakti remains. Shakti is power or strength in the Indian context. Power in the Indian context equates to feminine energy. Drag helped me find myself in a way that society and its rules do not allow. This is the first show where I am going by Durga Shakti, and soon I will legally change my last name to Shakti, free of all the rules of patriarchy. One day I will give the name Shakti to all the abandoned queer and trans children that I adopt. The following video is a collection of emotion and expression of self-love, frustration, dysphoria, kindness, and hope. I hope you enjoy it.
incredible.
Yeah, they're awesome.
Incredible.
They're really great.
I feel so lucky that we were able to feature them. Yeah. How did you come across and meet Durga?
Well, I mean, obviously, it was very important to have representation in this show. We don't need another show with just white drag kings, obviously.
Yeah.
So there are hundreds, if not thousands, of incredible POC performers within the drag community. And I just was really looking for people who, one, seemed responsive and just like really into what they were doing, passionate, like it's a huge part of their heart and soul that they're doing, while also very much supporting the rest of their community, people less fortunate in their community, and trying mm-hmm. to make a positive impact with their drag. And Durga just showed up. Durga's incredible. I think a lot of us, you know, we talk about things we need to work on within our own communities, but there's so many different aspects of other communities. Like the fact that Durga is the first kind of existing drag king in India, mm-hmm. I just keep thinking of how brave they are and how much them taking their space is creating that raindrop effect mm-hmm. for more queer artists in India. And I'm just excited to support them in any way I can. It's actually 5 a.m. where they are right now, so they're probably fast asleep.
Yes.
So if you're thinking about tipping them, I'm sure they'd love to wake up to it. But no, I feel like we're very privileged to be featuring them tonight. So
for sure. Yeah. And you know, all of our performers tonight, including yourself, are trailblazers in their own rights. But it definitely feels like Durga is on a mission.
Right.
Like you said, to sort of create space in India for the queer community.
Well, I think it kind of bounces off of what Jaden said, is they're trying to kind of, you know, Jaden wants to see more of a certain thing in this world, and they're trying to be that thing. And mm-hmm. I think really any artist right now, especially queer artists who are having the bravery to say, no, I exist, this is my space, and I'm great, and I'm working hard at this, and
yes.
appreciate me, is a trailblazer. So any positive force within our community and continuing to like support those positive forces, I think really the thing is people get really competitive in the arts mm-hmm. when there's enough money for everybody. There's enough audience members for everybody. We can sell out every single show. Everyone can get paid. And I think, and this really speaks in towards of elevating drag kings, but I think when we stop focusing on the teardowns of each other in drag and like the appeal of like fiercely ripping into each other to be the best and really start focusing on the more important things within our community, like uplifting performers of color, mm-hmm. focusing that drag can be for anybody. Kings can be cis men. Kings can be trans men. Kings can be non-binary kings. They can be anybody. We start protecting people within our community and just uplifting them, just as you see with Durga's work and Jaden's work and hopefully my work. I just think like working together as a community, there's so much more benefits to reap if we all realize we're working together and not against each other. So yeah, I had to stand up. I have a lot to say.
I know. I
had to stand up. I've been too fired up.
So. I'm happy you did stand up because that was amazing. And you know, I'm not even going to try to add on to that because it was so perfectly worded. So thank you.
I'll be backstage and I'll hear a performer, you know, making fun of someone who's not there because they've worn the same costume mm-hmm. more than once. That's classist. Mm-hmm. And it's also like, if your performing is very good, you don't need to rip down other people to show how good you are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that sort of attitude is slowly being kind of recognized for what it is, which is toxic. And more healthy relationships are getting integrated to drag, which is what you see with it becoming more diverse and realizing mm-hmm. it's not just for the cool kids or the real queens or like the passing performers. It's for all artists mm-hmm. who are professional and kind and love what they do.
Well, and all of those lessons, they should be acknowledged and recognized within the drag community, but also just within our society and our world, like outside, just in our everyday lives. You know what I mean?
Well, I'll tell you something, you know, it's great for us all to be in this kind of like echo chamber where queer people support queer arts and things like that. But I'll tell you, working a corporate gig, I've never seen so many boring people look so happy in my life. Like, drag is mainstream at this point. It's on television. It's in movies. It has been for years. It's becoming normalized.
It's at the Museum of Science.
It's at the Museum of Science. We're everywhere. We're not going to stop. You might as well just hire us because we're delightful.
Yes. Speaking of delightful, we have reached our final performer tonight. But as I've said with every single one, I'm so excited to see this performer. Can you tell us a little bit more?
Yes. So I'm so excited. I got to do one of these. Hercules is incredible. They're from Canada. They are iconic. That's the only way to talk about them. Their brand of drag, I don't know anyone else like them. They absolutely stand out. They're one of those faces that pop up when you hashtag drag kings, because their work simply speaks for itself. There's something so professional and well presented about them. It's just like, if they could, they would be glossy. Like, they're just that perfect, you know. But anyway, I'm so delighted to bring to the screen Hercules.
Hello, my name is Meg Fitzgerald, and I'm an illustrator, writer, and art director. Out of drag, I am best known for being the creator of feminist comics and graphic novels. But in drag, I am also known as the Fabulous Hercules. I'm 33 years old, and I started drag just over 3 years ago. But I was actually interested in drag for a really long time before I actually got the courage to take the plunge. It took me a little while to find my groove within the kink scene because I'm not really drawn to contemporary conventional masculine aesthetics, and I thought that's what I had to emulate to be a king. Also, I spent a lot of my early teen years pretending to have crushes on members of boy bands just to fit in with my friends. And so there's no part of me as an adult that wants to go out on stage and lip sync to the Backstreet Boys. My numbers are kind of weird. They're theatrical, they're narrative, they're sometimes sort of similar to performance art. And that means they're not for everybody. Not everyone will get it, not everyone will connect with it, and that is totally, totally fine. I am making this as my art. I'm not making it to get big and famous. The look I'm doing today is this one, and it's based on this teacup, which my grandpa bought for me at a garage sale when I was about 7, and I thought it was so special. I studied art history, so a lot of my inspiration comes from artists who've done cross-dressing or gender bending in their work. I've also had a lifelong fascination with Greek mythology, hence my namesake of Hercules. And I'm a huge history nerd. And so I love to pull inspiration from previous eras of menswear when it was just more ornate. Fashion historians have a term for when menswear became more sedate and streamlined, and it's called the Great Male Renunciation. One of the things that sparked this was sort of an influencer of his day, Beau Brummel. He popularized the precursor to the suit that we know now, which dominates all of men's formal wear. I'm really interested in this renunciation period and everything that came before it. Like, back when wealthy men were wearing ruffles and silks and lace and flowers and diamonds and heels, and all of those things were just considered quintessentially masculine.
I make a lot of things from upcycled secondhand material. So, like, this here is a sort of Tudor style cape and shirt. And this was originally a prom dress, a blazer, and then two different women's dress shirts that I totally changed the shape of and sewed back together. So all in all, there's also pants for this outfit. It cost me maybe $50 worth of secondhand material for something that looks really finished.
When I'm wearing clothing that's inspired by the wealthy elite men of the past, I feel like I'm leeching their power and status and emboldening myself with it. I'm absorbing the confidence that comes with male privilege and subverting it by wearing it on my queer female body. I'm essentially appropriating their way of dress for some really gay entertainment laced with some political messages. There are a lot fewer opportunities for kings to perform than there are for queens. In general, it's just an issue of there not being enough space made for cis women, trans men, and other non-binary AFAB people in this scene. This isn't helped by the fact that, according to the representation we see on a popular drag reality TV show, we apparently don't exist in this community. People will sometimes make the argument that kings just can't be as entertaining as queens because performing masculinity is inherently much less glamorous and exciting than performing femininity. And I just think that argument is so bogus. People who argue that have never made an effort to go to an all-king show or obviously aren't checking out kings on Instagram, so it comes from a place of pure ignorance. I think that we have to start addressing this imbalance for what it is. It's gender discrimination, and it's really prevalent in the drag world. There's a widely assumed belief that men are better at this job than women and AFAB people are. It's just harder to disambiguate it in our industry because we are in literal gender disguises, and that can really muddle the matter. But when you remove the costumes, it is just a classic case of bad misogyny. Hercules has taught me so much. There are things I do in drag that every day kind of shock me because they are so unlike me outside of drag. I've been taught my whole life that modesty is a virtue, and he's just this huge egomaniac. It is so empowering to embody the skin of somebody who is so completely unapologetic. It's a truly liberating feeling to take up space, to receive compliments and know that they're true, and to be seen. For me, deciding to do drag has been about committing to learning a million new little skill sets. I have learned makeup from scratch. I've really improved my sewing and my crafting. I've learned basic photography and photo editing and video making. Learning dance choreography is an ongoing challenge, I'd say. And now I'm just starting to learn how to make wigs and make lace-backed facial hair pieces. It really feels like the possibilities to be creative with drag are endless, and as long as there are new challenges to tackle, I know that I'll be hooked. Thanks for watching, and remember, all drag is valid.
The looks.
Yeah.
I can't.
So I don't know if they're bombarded with this all the time, but just simply from like how well they are at directing just that small video, Hercules, if you have the time, interest, or energy, and you want to start doing any sort of online tutorials or classes, I will sign up. I will pay for a monthly fee. Just, you're learning so many skills, and you're so good at explaining your thoughts and your process. So if you do that, please let me know.
I can't believe that they've only been doing drag for 3 years. Like,
that's the thing, is like there's a lot of people with pre-existing artistic talents who just get into drag and apply like their own talents in their own ways. Like, I definitely am taking my ballet experience to be Throb, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's really, because then you get all these really fun, quirky strengths from different areas, but yeah.
So I want to go back to this question that we kind of started with and that has come up several times. Mm-hmm. You know, Hercules points it out quite clearly in their video. How do we end the misogyny and the discrimination in this field? Because it's disheartening as an audience member to hear that the communities that in society sort of face these issues, women, people of color, the queer community, mm-hmm. are, you know, within this, what should be a safe space and a safe community of artists, are still encountering it. So is there anything that we as audience members or producers can do?
So I've got 3 bits of advice. I don't have the end-all answer to that question. I am but one little spooky pumpkin person.
Yeah.
But that said, first thing I would say is, if you're an audience member, if you're a performer, if you're a producer, it's wonderful when there's diversity in a cast. It's wonderful when you're able to feature performers from different backgrounds or places or identities. But what's better is when you attend and encourage shows curated mm-hmm. by those people. It's great when you can provide the space, but it is so much more important to support them creating the space. If there's one show that filters through a different cast, that's great. But if there's 8 shows of 8 different producers from, and you're not just getting the same perspective. So the first thing I would say is, if you want to see more performers of color, if you want to see more body positivity, if you want to see more inclusivity, support your shows. But the minute there is a show by and for people who aren't given the same opportunities, you get out your money and you go to that show. You help, you ask how you can help with that show. That's just a gigantic part of helping this community grow that much faster. Because if we know anything about being a working artist, it's that you are your own support. So the more your community lifts you up, the easier it is to flourish and grow. So community, support the people you say you support. Mm-hmm. The next thing I would say to anyone who isn't a drag king and really wants to create a better environment for kings or things or when you work with them is simply listen to them. It's easy to get defensive. This is a hard hustle. I get it. You're working your best. You're trying really hard. But these experiences are real. They absolutely happen and they're valid. You know, you have to really consider not just your audience's experience, but your performer and your cast experience working with you. You know, if this show isn't about you, then who is it about? It's about your audience and it's about your cast. And when it comes to working with kings, there is a whole different group of experiences and problems that you probably haven't experienced yourself. But if you're going to be a responsible producer, you need to listen to those experiences, you need to take them seriously, and then you need to take actions to address those problems. You will see nothing but appreciation, and it can literally only help you to listen and become a better producer. And my final bit of advice is to all the beautiful drag kings and things in between who exist now and will exist in the future. What you got is great. If you want to be, you know, a performer for money, if you want to be a performer for fun, if you're just getting into it, if you've been in it for a while, whatever you are, you're perfect the way you are. Just keep working hard. But you need to understand, no one's going to work as hard for you as you are. Opportunities will not be handed to you on a silver platter. There is not someone around the corner waiting to show up and make your dreams come true for you. If you want to be a performing artist and you want to that to be a substantial part of your life, you need to work on it and see it as any other job. Part of normalizing artists as people with jobs and not just people with hobbies is being professional, which means being reliable, being communicative, reaching out, networking. It's like any other job in the world. You've got to care about it and you've got to really believe in yourself, and then you just have to do it. And when you mess up, because you will, you're going to mess up a lot. You need to learn from it. Apologize if necessary. Learn, grow, keep going. And that's kind of my best advice to you, is work as hard for yourself as you wish other people would work for you, and respect the people's time that you want to respect your time. And that would be my advice.
And that is that. That, I mean, it's amazing, and thank you for that. So I could sit here and talk to you really all night about all of this, but I know the questions are rolling in through the Q&A, so we're going to jump to that. But I had a question that I wanted to...
I'm an Aquarius.
that I wanted to pose to you, and it's kind of a loaded one, so... sorry in advance, but given our current world and our global situation, what is the future of drag?
Oh man, I wish I knew the answer to that. the fact is, this cannot last forever. Things will never be as they were exactly, but like anything else, things will change. Life is a roller coaster. As soon as you're up, things can go down, but you will go up again. And that is the same with the performing lifestyle. If you are like me, who really wants to just kind of play this game, this is an excellent opportunity to network. This is an excellent opportunity to meet people outside your community, to find inspiration, to practice, to do it for yourself, to see if you really enjoy doing this. I was in a show in Argentina the other month, which is insane because I never would have networked with those people. Yeah. But everyone who I'm meeting now, when eventually live shows can exist again, are people I'm absolutely going to network in the future so I can feature them in live entertainment, which is what I'm actually passionate about. I think right now it's just a matter of just keeping clear what's important to the drag community, building on that, having this time to have discussions so then we can implement them in the future when live shows become a thing again. Because they will come back.
They will.
And this happens anytime there is great pain in the world. Artists show up. Mm-hmm. They show up. And I sincerely believe with my black little heart that there will be a renaissance of art when live theater can exist again, because people need it. Performers need it. Audience members need it. It's just such an integral part of the human experience that is the need for art to exist. And mm-hmm. I think the minute we can be safe and responsible again, audiences are going to want to be entertained. Performers are going to want to be on a stage. They're going to have all these months of ideas. So just keep existing. It'll come back. Just we gotta wait and be safe. That's yes. the most important thing.
Be safe. That's why
check out some digital shows. You'll see some amazing artists you would never otherwise see in real life.
Exactly.
Bitch Puddin's digital drag kind of was the beginning of this digital drag age. I can't believe how many digital drag shows there are. There's so many. Mm-hmm. Just go watch some art and then follow it.
And there's a ton of just even digital shows happening within our local scene.
Absolutely. One of my favorite Boston performers, Violencia exclamation point.
Yes.
Incredible. Okay, this performer is an amazing producer, is so kind, is so welcoming. They're one of the first people to start booking me when I started doing drag and have always had me feeling safe and cared for. They really care about the trans members of this community. They really care about drag for all. They will stand up for you in a second. They've started doing actually a network of shows. They took their real life show, made it into a digital show, Serve, and now there's a whole Serve network. So they're providing space for mm-hmm. other drag artists to now produce their own shows as well, which is exactly putting your money where your mouth is. So find Violencia, check out their network. Boston is teaming with talent.
Thriving.
So go check them out.
Thriving.
Say hi.
Yes.
Draw on a mustache. Give it a shot.
Thank you so much, Throb. The audience is just inundating our Q&A right now. So I just want to transition to that
sure.
part of the night. If you still have a question and you have not submitted it yet, you still can. This is a reminder. All you have to do is go to slido.com. slido.com and enter the code DRAGKING and it'll pop up right here on my screen and we'll try and get through it. So let's just start. So this is a perfect segue. Throb, what are the differences and the challenges of switching from a live show medium to an online medium?
Oh, they're awful. I've personally had a lot of trouble with it. I'm actually taking a bit of a step back kind of after this, and I have another show or two right after. I've had an incredibly hard time. My performance is very much churned out for the excitement of connecting with my audience and, you know, interactive and just being a part of, it's just the energy, which is a huge part of why I do what I do. So now without that, trying to create acts, not dancing very much with poor tech support, I'm personally struggling with it greatly, but I'm hoping to find what does make me happy, which is trying to do bigger projects, instead of many, few and good, I guess is the way you would say it. So I'm hoping to actually work with my troupe to like take on a 5-month long project to bring you like an hour long show where we like really bounced ideas and took time. The like fast churning out of digital acts has been very hard for me. Mm-hmm. But I know some performers who have taken it to like a duck to water because maybe their strong point wasn't dancing, but their strong point is their lip sync is on point. Their makeup is flawless. They're getting to use a bunch of skills they wouldn't normally get to use in live theater, and they're doing amazing work. So I think for everyone, it's different. I think it's kind of how drag brings enjoyment to you, and there's kind of very much a cockroach mindset within the drag scene right now is you can't stop it. It will find a way to survive. And I think some people are just really being creative and making it work for them. And me personally, I'm getting there. I'm getting there. It's just a very big change. And I miss everyone.
What do you do to maintain a good and positive mental health and headspace while doing so much incredible work, especially during these wild times?
One word, and that's boundaries.
Yes.
Boundaries are incredibly important, especially as a drag king. As an AFAB performer, I mentioned this earlier, I immediately had a very big issue with the fact that I would go backstage to almost any show and immediately be sexualized or even grabbed, just like really stuff that wouldn't be appropriate if a cis man was doing it to me backstage, but was somehow okay because I was a drag king in a room full of queens and no one batted an eye. So for me, boundaries are just the most important. It's boundaries with yourself. It's boundaries with the people you work with. It's about respecting your space and your time. For me, taking a step back, for instance, is a boundary. I'm finding a lot of digital acts don't make me happy to create them. I get very upset, but I feel this pressure to be present and to meet and to network. Well, it's not making me happy. Mm-hmm. So that's a boundary. And when I work with people, it's the same thing. If I got asked to do a show and I realized early on I can't bring my best, and I know just making something subpar is going to make me unhappy, it's wasting my time, it's wasting the producer's time, it's wasting the audience's time. So just stand up for yourself. If you don't like something, say something about it. Communicate with people. It's all about communication. Mm-hmm. It's all about communication, being honest with yourself, respecting yourself, and not dying.
That's great advice. How can gender nonconforming individuals mm-hmm. live loud and fierce and proud, even in their everyday lives and mundane careers?
Once again, I hate to say it again, is boundaries, in my opinion, are super important. You know, everyone has their own bandwidth of what they're comfortable. Like, for instance, with me, pronouns don't particularly upset me. I feel very confident in my identity, things like that. So it's not something I personally need. But when I start a new job, it doesn't matter how mundane it is. On my resume, I say I'm a performing artist. And when they say, what do you do? I say, well, I do drag and I do burlesque. And if that's an issue with where I work, then I don't work there. Mm. Now, I know some people don't have that same privilege. I know some people are in different situations where it isn't safe to be your authentic self. That's kind of a life you have to build yourself towards. Mm. So there's nothing wrong with you. What's wrong is your surroundings. So hold on to yourself. Find people who support you and recognize you for who you are and celebrate. Don't not just tolerate who you are. They celebrate who you are. People who just tolerate your existence, you don't have time for that. So don't waste your time on those relationships. Find community that supports you and sees you and validates you. You know, they're out there. They're out there. There's nothing wrong with you. Your family's just, you know, somewhere else, and you have to find them and search them out. It's the same with working. If you're able to, you need to be honest about who you are. Bosses, companies need to start acknowledging that non-binary people, trans people, people who are not cisgender are just as real and valid. And if that means you need to make people a little uncomfortable and you can do that safely to stand up for yourself, I fully encourage you to do so.
Hmm. What are your suggestions to combat trans misogyny in our society and the drag scene at the same time that we are combating misogyny?
I think if you're not a person like that, and you're simply someone who cares about there being more equality, who cares about there being more recognition and respect, is you need to stand up for them. If you see something, you need to stand up for people. The more we collectively start communicating in spaces, even if it makes people uncomfortable, that intolerance isn't tolerated around me. Mm. I'm sorry if that makes you uncomfortable, but your lack of tolerance, your lack of kindness, your lack of compassion isn't welcome around me. So people just need to start getting called out on things. And what's great is people can learn and they can get better. And that's wonderful. People should be allowed to make mistakes as long as they learn and become better, because that's how we become stronger, by supporting each other, not just canceling, canceling, canceling. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people just have never been told that that's not okay. And maybe they should know better, but sometimes they don't. So if you want a stronger surrounding, start standing up for people, start standing up for yourself. You don't have to deal with that. It's not you against the world. There's lots of people who will absolutely support you and what you need. So just be clear about who you are, be clear about what you will and won't stand for, and change will happen the more we all stand up for all of us.
Drag is usually presented as very binary gendered. Is it because the market is harder to navigate for non-binary people, or is that because of public perception or demand?
In my opinion, it'd be public perception. Yeah. I mean, when you hear of drag, most people's first experience with drag is mainstream television drag, where it often is about who is the most womanly. That's simply what's in the limelight right now. I don't think it will be like that forever. And if you look at a lot of other performers, it creeps in, you know, whether it's by being an ugly woman, things like that. It's sinking in because the whole point is, you know, we all say this collectively, gender constructs are made up, which they are. So when you want to go with a very strong male or female impression, it's still a parody. It's still an impersonation. You know, it's not to say, these are such big questions, and I am such a small person.
You're giving your perspective, and I think that's what
I am.
This is about, and it's you're nailing it.
I also think, you know, if you're a performer and you find yourself surrounded by majorly performers who go in that direction, whereas you might be a more fluid performer, what a chance for you to stand out.
Yeah.
That's an advantage, baby. That's an advantage. You want to be the one part of the show people remember the most because you dared to be something different. And sometimes that can really work out in your favor. So it's not that you don't fit in. It's that you're an extra special flavor.
Yeah.
And enjoy that. Project that. Be proud of the fact that you are something fresh and exciting because you are. There's a reason this is becoming more normalized. Because it's good. Because people like it.
Yeah, that's perfect. This is a really interesting question, and I'm just very curious. What is your ideal audience member?
My ideal audience member is someone who wants to have a good time, because that is what I, as a performer, am there to give you. It's so funny. I'll watch videos of me performing, and there's always, you know, some people really excited, some people super excited, and there's always a few people like this. And I don't know what their problem is. I'm not even sure why they're there, because I know I'm giving them all I've got. And really, what I hope to do as a performer and producer is make people happy.
Yeah.
So obviously, as a performer, don't be creepy and gross. You know, don't touch performers without consent. I mean, use common sense. My ideal audience member is someone who enters in the space, appreciates and respects the performers, and respects themselves and the space and the experience. Just have a good time. Let us show you a good time. Don't be a jerk. Just let us share this wonderful thing with you. Come into this world with us.
And you just perfectly described your audiences as well. Like, you, Slaughterhouse is such a diehard community of fans.
They're
and
wonderful.
Audience that literally show up for every single show and are the kindest audience members for a venue to welcome in.
Well, you need to really respect your audience, because, you know, I've seen times where people have not really taken performing seriously, and it's like, money is money is money. And if someone is finding a way to get to the venue, to pay for the price, to probably have a drink, they're there, then spend 2 hours and all of that, I want to be worthy of their time. I want to be worthy of their attention and their money. I mean, obviously, I want to make art that's reflective of me. I don't make art just to sell. I make art because I love making art. But you need to respect your audience. They're people who are there to support you. And again, it's kind of that producer-performer relationship. By treating them well, you will only gain good things. You can only, literally, you can only profit off of considering your audience. And they're also wonderful people who love you. So, you know,
but
be
I
nice
think,
to them.
And I think that that's why you've created such a, you have, Slaughterhouse has created a community, because I feel like your audience, your fans feel like they're a part of your process. They feel like they're a part of your shows. And because you are so kind to them and you get to know all of them, it's just, I think that they're just a perfect shining example of everything you're talking
about. What I'm really hoping to create with Slaughterhouse shows is, you know, they are undeniably queer events. They're very gay. But they're not exclusive. You know, as long as you support everybody, then you're welcome. You know, one of my favorite is I actually love straight men in my audience. I love straight men in my audience because they are so comfortable with themselves. They are having such a good time. I have a few male friends who are actually ex-military, and my troop does this whole military act, and you just see them and they're just whistling and they're loving every second of it. And they're just so excited because they don't have entertainment like that usually in their face. You know, it's not, it's a sort of like modern day clowning that I don't think a lot of people get to have outside of drag. Mm-hmm. So like, yeah, everyone's welcome as long as you're there to have a good time.
Everyone is welcome. So we do have to start to wrap up, but I just, our final question, and this is combining a lot of questions that we have received. So I'll just sort of generalize it. For people who have watched this and now want to become a drag performer, like where should they start?
Well, I mean, obviously in present day times, that's kind of a complicated question because no one can really be on stage right now, at least not in Boston. I hear it's different in some areas, but around here, that's still not safe. Again, I would say getting into drag is a lot like getting into burlesque, is a lot like getting into theater. Start going to the shows. Mm-hmm. Start giving to the community. Because if you just walk into a community of people who work really, really hard and had to scrape for every ounce of space they got and say, I demand to be given space in your space, you will not get anywhere. You cannot have this expectation of other people like that. Performers are also people with their own problems and their own lives. You know, you can't just come in and expect to be given a drag career. Mm-hmm. I would say go to shows, start caring about the community, give to it, say you're interested. There's definitely open performance spaces in Boston. Like, find me on social media and ask about them. I will send you in a bunch of different directions because we're lucky enough in Boston to have a lot of producers who welcome newcomers and create space for everyone and anyone, no matter your skill level, which is so important. So if you're, again, looking to do that locally, I'm happy to list a bunch of producers or shows, things like that. And of course, that question is the same, but also very different when things eventually open up again. So,
but are there skill sets that they can take this time to learn? Like, what do you recommend to start with? Makeup, with developing a character, or is it different for everyone?
I think, I don't know if I know anyone who would say this, but for me, it's get comfortable with your musicality. Mm. I'm not the strongest lip syncer. I'll be the first one to say it, but I know my music and I like to move. And like when you're on stage, your mouth is here, but the stage is here. Learn to take up space. Used to like hit those beats to like enjoy, to get into your music. Let the music inspire like what you want your face to look like. And just start playing with makeup. Just start playing with it. Cause like when I start, I never know where I'm gonna end up. Some people sketch out faces in advance. Really just start taking in art, finding inspiration, and then just start trying things. Don't be afraid to fall down a few times and just start building upon that. So I would say play with makeup, listen to music, like really listen to music, like listen to it. Don't just dance around to it, like let it sink into your skin. Like close your eyes, turn off the lights, make sure you're not gonna run into any furniture and just feel the music, imagine the space, start enjoying it. Because one thing, regardless of your skill level, that people love to see in a performance is you having a good time. Mm. I've said this a few times. I've, you know, with this digital drag age, we're doing our best, but I'll see, you know, videos of clearly professional performers like twirling and flipping and splitting, and it's great. But compared to the excitement of seeing a new performer with basically wearing their work clothes, just lip syncing for their life because they feel so them in that moment and they're drinking in that energy, I would pay, take that anytime.
Yeah.
I love that. That energy of you enjoying yourself. People want to support positive things. So if you put out there, I love this, I'm enjoying this, I'm having fun, I'm feeling comfortable, people like to share that with you. So experiment with makeup, have fun with music, fall in love with yourself through drag, and then share that with people, however that forms for you. And that's how I would say get into drag or performing.
I love it. Throb, Zombie, thank you so much for being here tonight, but for collaborating with us on this project and bringing such an incredible lineup of performers from literally all over the world.
We're all so amazing, appreciative.
And thank you to those performers. We hope that you're watching or that you'll watch after, depending on where you are in the world. It was truly an honor for us to share your stories tonight and to share your work. Thank you to the Lowell Institute once again for making tonight possible. And thank you to all of you for watching and spending your Thursday night with us. We hope to see you back in our fall season when it kicks off on the 15th. Until then, stay safe, stay healthy, and have a great night. Thank you.